Greetings and welcome to this special edition of Montpelier Connection. Today we're here to discuss the news that just came out today from the Energy Corporation that in 2014 they will be closing and beginning the decommission process at Vermont Yankee. Today we're here with Mollie Burke, Tristan Toleno, Jeanette White, and Val Stuart here, part of your Windham County delegation. I think all of us would like to register a little bit of a comment on what's happened today, and I think starting from my perspective, while it's a little bit of a surprise, it's not a great surprise to me. We've been hearing intimations about this for a while. I think a lot of us are concerned about some of the workers there, but the hope is that Entergy will step up and do the right thing by their workers. They've earned millions and millions over the years, and hopefully they will share some of that and help their workers have a soft landing. Other concern I think many of us share is that the decommissioning fund is not whole, and we certainly hope that the corporate entity Entergy makes good on that. Mollie?
Well, I certainly share your concerns about the workers and about the storage of the waste and what's going to happen. Is it going to be sitting there for 60 years in safe store? Are we going to be able to get it out of there? What about the spent fuel pool that has many more rods than should have in there? So there are a lot of concerns, but I was heartened to hear the governor today talk about working together, and I think this is a good opportunity to really work with Entergy, the state, to solve a lot of these problems.
So, I have a lot of friends who work at the plant, and I'm thinking of them, and I'm also thinking about the transitions that our community will need to go through. But I also think that something about today's announcement should hopefully clarify for people that sometimes change happens because of activism or policymakers, and sometimes because business models change. And what we saw today from the announcement is that the business model for the nuclear power industry is shifting in response to the natural gas industry's sort of explosive growth over the last decade, and that we could maybe move beyond the politics of blame and look at how we move forward as a community, recognizing that there are people who are going to want to stay here, who may be losing their jobs quicker than they thought, and that there are also opportunities that they may bring new entrepreneurial energy to the community, and we need to look at how we build that out in the future.
So I'm not terribly surprised. I expected this, but I didn't expect it for maybe another year or so, and expected it to be based on exactly what they said it was based on, which is the economic model. I attended the press conference, so got some, I think some of the concerns that we've raised already. I'm not going to address them now, but we can talk about them when we start our conversations. But I have to say that I'm pleased. I'm worried about Windham County. I'm worried about the people that are working there, but I'm pleased that it's going to close.
Yeah, and I'd just like to echo Jeanette and Mike's sentiments in particular. I think what we're most concerned about as Windham County delegation would be the people and the workers who have lost their jobs. Obviously, we want to make sure that we continue to work in the legislature to grow jobs in Vermont, clean, green jobs that basically dovetail with our values. I think we're really fortunate at this point in time. It wasn't a matter of when. If Vermont Yankee closed, it was a matter of when. And I think we're really fortunate that we have a governor from this neck of the woods who cares about this region, who is a savvy businessman, who is going to work closely with Entergy to make sure that we do this job in the best way possible for Vermonters. So I think that also a lot of people, I think, are really happy to see this happen, and I think it's a good thing. I think we have to turn lemons into lemonade. I think Sevids and the BDCC have been working on this for a long time, so this doesn't come as a surprise. We have been working on when Vermont Yankee closes, what are we going to do? So I think we have some strategies, and I just like to also say that we have a fabulous new head. Jeff Lewis was a great director of BDCC, and now we have a powerhouse in Pat Moulton Powden. So who is the new director of BDCC. So I think we're really fortunate that this is the time. It was inevitable, and now we have to move forward and really move into a positive energy future that dovetails with Vermont and Vermonters' values.
For a long time, many of us in the legislature have been concerned about the decommissioning fund. Estimates of decommissioning started at $1 billion and go upwards of that. There's nowhere near that in the decommissioning fund. Jeanette, you have followed this and been part of the legislature longer than any of us. What can we do to make sure they make that whole?
Well, I think that the question is, how is it decommissioned? Because at the press conference today, they said that, and I don't remember the exact number, but I would think it was $542 million is currently in the decommissioning fund. That's enough to satisfy the NRC standard for safe store, which is essentially mothballing it for 60 years. So if they go that route, it is whole. If they do what Vermonters or most Vermonters want, and I think it would be to our advantage to have it decommissioned sooner so that that site becomes available for some other use. At the press conference today, they didn't commit to doing safe store or full decommissioning. What they said is that they have the right to do safe store. Vermonters want more, and they'll work with the state to try and figure out what's the best. They're going to do a site-specific study and find out what's the best way to do this. And the question was, if you do that, are you going to have to put more money into the fund? And they said that remains to be seen when we do the study. So I don't think they didn't take a firm position on one end or the other of the spectrum. So in my opinion, we push them to do the full decommissioning right away instead of, or as much as possible, instead of the safe store.
I wonder if we can go back and or go forward next year with legislation to force that.
I don't know if it's legislation or...
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm not sure that we have the capacity to force that. I think it's more about what, you know, what we can do in conversation and negotiation and working.
One of the good things, I think, that's come out of our work in the last few years is, if you remember several years ago, they tried to create a shell corporation, which is the corporate strategy usually when a company is about to go out of business and they create a corporation with no assets and it collapses under the weight of itself. One of the good things, I think, is that we didn't let that happen. And so that there is going to be some substance to what the corporation has now.
And I think we have to applaud all the grassroots organizations, too, Mike, that have really worked so hard on this issue because they really helped push and make sure that that didn't happen. So, you know, kudos to the people out there. You know, we always need public input, and the public really needs to be part and a partner in the process of, you know, working to make this the best state in the union.
You know, one of the things that, one of the questions that was asked at the press conference today was if they had signed a contract with the Vermont Utilities 2 years ago when they were negotiating, would that have changed this outcome? And they said no.
It wouldn't have.
Well, and there was a plant in California that, earlier this year that made the same decision not to pursue relicensing, and it was explicitly because of the cost pressure, you know, in the competitive marketplace, and that. So it stands to reason that that would be true, that they wouldn't have, that the contract alone would not have made it possible for them to stay in business. The market is very, very sensitive to price, and they can't win on that price.
And I think that natural gas isn't the only economic. They have to put a lot of money into it. They put a lot of money into it in the last 10 years, and they have to put a lot more money into it if they were going to continue to operate. And they also, and I don't quite know exactly how this works, but because they're a merchant plant, the ISO, somehow they get, they don't get the same kind of pricing mm-hmm. that other
people do.
Right, and I think, yeah, looking at the 25-year investment horizon or whatever the length of that would have been, that's where that competitive question comes into balance is, you know, do you anticipate the landscape changing in your favor over 25 years or 20 years? And that seems like clearly that the market has shifted away from the viability of plants of their mm-hmm. type.
Mm-hmm. I thought it was interesting listening to the Vermont edition today and Jane Lindholm asking, why didn't, if you knew all these factors, and we've known these factors, the economics of it, why go through this court case and all of that, and sort of kept pushing that question. And I think one of the interesting things for me is that this, to me, it vindicates the state's case, about, we were talking about economic viability and reliability of the, and here are the reasons why they're stating that they're going out. And, it's just sort of an interesting twist in this whole saga of the court case and then losing the appeal. And so just interesting how economics drives.
But they had to do the court case because it would have set a precedent for the entire nuclear industry mm-hmm. if this little mm-hmm. tiny state had told them.
Sure.
So they had to go to
the next step, too, because of the precedent that court case sets on determining legislative intent.
Divining is what the court said, that the courts have the right to divine legislative
intent. What people mean when they're...
Yeah. I mean, certainly I was thinking, I'm obviously new to the legislature, but I was thinking about how in committee testimony, I might ask a question not from my own personal position, but from a sort of a proxy position as a way of teasing out an issue that I think is really important to put on the table or something like that. And I was thinking that the precedent that court case set says that could in fact be interpreted at face value mm-hmm. By a court, and that could trump my vote on a particular issue that had specific language. Yeah. And I personally hope that the state chooses to appeal it all the way, and that we perhaps can get a better standard for determining legislative intent above and beyond the issue of VY.
Yeah.
It's not just a detail, really, but as energy, whether we like it or not, and sometimes they threw their weight around inappropriately, in my view, but they did give for this area quite a bit of money to nonprofits, so that is going to leave a mm-hmm. hole in a number of nonprofits. I mean, I worked for Youth Services, the Brattleboro Museum and Art Center, the Strolling of the Heifers, among others, and they, so that is one other group that we are going to have to think about the ramifications of this. But, mm-hmm. The exciting thing, I think, is that back in the I guess it was maybe February or so, Margaret Cheney, basically, who is the vice chair of the House Natural Resources and Energy Committee. Some of you may have heard of this. I don't know that you were able to attend, but she held something at the Marlboro Tech Center, and it was all about solar and renewable energy sources. There were like 80 different people there from all different companies, all of which were from this area. And it was such an exciting conversation with all these new companies, some smaller, some larger, but really very energetic discussion around renewable energy. So maybe some of those companies, certainly they have a social consciousness in terms of the environment, so maybe they will also help support our local nonprofits. Because Entergy did do a decent job of that. I mean, they did support the local community, and there are a lot of people that are at Entergy that are good people, and like Mike started out with, and we all echoed the sentiment of we have to take care of the Vermonters who work there. But I think we will. I think this is, I think we're moving forward in a positive way into the future. We have a great delegation. We have an excellent governor.
Well, I certainly hope the company does, too.
Yeah.
I know that our concerns have not been with the local people, but with the corporate, mm-hmm. Going back to when they tried to create this shell corporation.
No question.
And with the decommissioning fund.
We have to keep holding their feet to the fire.
Exactly.
We've known that from the start, and basically they haven't been a good corporate citizen in terms of Vermont overall. And
locally
economics
they have
drove
have
this
done some things.
But economics drove this decision, and we all know that, and we knew that from the start. So we knew who we were, you know, up against, and basically, you know, the day came when they said, economically, this doesn't work. So actually, they're the people who basically are letting the people go, not us, not the state.
You know, when the court cases came up, we were told to be careful about talking about safety, but there are going to be safety issues going forward. There's some questions now about whether the radiological measurements that are coming out are accurate. Yesterday, I think there was another either positive or false positive. Do others here see this as our purview, or do we need to continue to step back because of the court cases and looking at safety issues around the decommissioning now?
Well, I think we need to be, depending on what the AG does, the Attorney General decides to do, along with the administration, I suppose, the decision is whether to reappeal, mm-hmm. and then on the other court case, I think we need to be very careful that we don't do something that would impact those cases mm-hmm. in a negative way. So I'm taking my, on those issues, I'm taking my lead from the Attorney General's office. Because I don't want to do, I have two bills in right now that have been drafted that will be introduced, well, now I don't know if they will be introduced, but they would have been introduced depending on the outcome of the court cases. Mm-hmm. So
I think we can also rely on a lot of the groups that have been working for the closure of the plant to raise those safety issues.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. to keep that in the public eye and to make sure that that's part of the conversation.
Mm-hmm. And this is not new to New England. There have been a number of other plants now that have closed and have mm-hmm. gone into the decommissioning process. So there's some precedent we can look at, and I hope we can utilize that knowledge that's been accrued over time. For years, we were hearing that if Vermont Yankee closes, the lights will go out and electric costs will go through the roof. Any thoughts to whether there's a reality to that?
We don't get Vermont doesn't get any power right now from Vermont Yankee.
Right.
Yeah. Zilch. None whatsoever.
Yep.
And about 2% of the New England grid? I think it's something like that.
Real small.
Mary
percentage.
Powell made a statement today. She's the head of Green Mountain Power.
Yep.
She made a statement today and said, not gonna make any difference to them or their customers at all.
I think regarding the jobs issue, I think there's a lot happening, I think, in Brattleboro under the radar that people are not really tuned into. People who have, who are employing five or six people. And it seems like sometimes people don't really count that as being, you're a small business owner, as being an important part of the economy, but it really is. And I think that's what we need to really focus on, is trying to help small businesses, you know, grow a little bit, maintain what they have, really think about the arts as an important part of our economy. I know there's been a lot of talk about that. There's some ways of looking at the community right now in terms of resources. So I see that this is leading us into a very hopeful place eventually.
And speaking of hopefulness, I mean, the Brattleboro Regional Academic Center that we basically helped get the 2.5 initial startup money for, that which is going to be in Brooks House. I mean, that's a great thing for our town. That's going to bring more students into town, more money into town, and just make a more vibrant Brattleboro. So there are a lot of great things happening in Commonwealth Dairy. Many of us attended the press conference there in, when was it, the fall? But, you know, they thought they were going to have five new jobs at this time, that time, of the press conference, and they had created like 10 times that number. So ROV Technologies, you know, five new jobs, 45,000 apiece. We helped draft legislation that helped that basically robotics company that actually goes in and cleans off nuclear inside nuclear power plants nationwide. We helped make it possible for them to get relief from the Texas Compact to the costly kind of tipping fees of that. So there are a lot of great things happening. I mean, Swiss Precision Tourney, Willie Buhlman, it's a smaller version of GS Precision. You know, he's my neighbor down the street. He has five new jobs, all high-paying jobs. So as a member of the House Education Committee, one of our big opportunities I see, and I'm sure you guys all see it too, is, you know, workforce development. The governor says this all the time. You know, we need to get people to fill some of the jobs we have right here, right now, by training them with two-year degrees, four-year degrees. Not everybody needs a degree. Some people just need the skill set. The ROV Technologies people, they just want people with the right skill set to come in and learn their job. So, you know, I think we have a bright future. We've been working really hard to do that in terms of, as a state, create new jobs, and I think we're doing it.
It is a time of transition. This area has gone through a number of transitions over the past few decades, and we are moving in nationwide a different economy. I know Tristan has talked about economic systems to anybody who listens, because he has a...
and some who won't.
I appreciate what you bring to those discussions. And
right. I mean, I think certainly... There are opportunities and there is change happening, and Brattleboro has gone through a number of cycles, or the Brattleboro area has gone through a number of cycles over the last 30 years, and we do have opportunity to reinvent ourselves. We're in a great position geographically. Mm-hmm. We have a wealth of really talented and interesting people, and certainly how the different forms that takes. The arts community has taken one form. The food and agriculture sector is an emerging area of economic opportunity in the state. And we have to also look at whether, Commonwealth I think is an example of this, whether there are places for sort of bigger size businesses to be anchored here. And part of the geographic advantage that we have is that we're very close to the significant demographic resources. From the New York, Boston, Philly, D.C., you know, the whole Northeast has a tremendous concentration of population and wealth, and we're within a day's delivery of that. So what we have to look at how we can maybe attract more businesses to start up here that can scale from here. And so there are a number of opportunities.
So many great things are happening that
hopefully we can add more. Money to the budget,
yeah. But you know, the economy is coming around slowly and, you know, but surely. And you know, the great news is I think we have a governor who's a business guy. You know, he gets it. You know, I mean, he and his administration, they're going to keep our AA, AAA bonding, you know, their basic bond rating. You know, they're going to keep this state strong. So any business people out there who are listening, I mean, you know, I think we're really all over a lot of different areas of growth, and you know, making sure that, you know, we move forward into the future with as strong economy as possible.
In looping back to the CEVED's ideas, it started out with wanting to look at life after VY, but it also now looks at the big picture of you know, what's been happening in Windham County for the last 20 years, and where do we want to go? And I think with that kind of intention and work moving forward, we do have a bright future here. We've got a minute left or so. Any final comments before we head out?
I'm pleased, but we have a lot of work ahead of us, and I think we need to acknowledge that it's going to be hard.
And I would just encourage us to move past the polarizing nature of this issue, and recognize that we are where we are, and we need to work together on building a future that we can that can sort of support the long-term sustainability of our communities, and that does mean putting aside the old arguments and working together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think And I think the point we are at in time, Mike, is basically that, you know, this just gives us renewed kind of commitment to doing what we really need to do as a state, which the governor and I think our delegation, I think we're all over, which is, you know, create jobs and basically create jobs in sectors that dovetail with Vermonters' values and the values of the state, and also educate our populace, so that we really need to continue our focus on workforce development, job creation, and maintaining our biggest asset, which is our working landscape.
And maintaining the quality of life.
No question.
That brought us, most of us, here to Vermont.
You bet.
We are, although it's just getting into September, we are preparing for the session in January, so they will be showing our contact information up as they roll the credits. So feel free to get in touch with us if you have ideas for legislation, things you'd like to see changed, things you'd like to move forward on. This is a good time to get in touch with us. So if you have ideas, please feel free to get in touch with us. And thank you for tuning in. Thanks again to the people here at BCTV that make this happen. And thanks again for watching, and take care.